Welcome to Tech Talk. Today's topic is passwordless authentication. I'm joined by Jeff, the security guy. A couple of your videos brought us to this topic where you talked about IAM or Identity Access Management and how that applies to rules for passwords, as well as MFA, multi-factor authentication. I'd like to get into a little bit closer about what is something you teased us with, the password nirvana, you called it. No password required.
No passwords.
Good. But before we get there, I want to show we're going to have a bonus feature for this one. It's called Personal Disaster Recovery.
I've had more than a few of those.
Sorry to hear that. It's going to be a quiz where you have eight choices, and we're going to see how you do.
Okay? All right.
So how can we get to that passwordless nirvana?
Yeah, well, if you think about where we are today, we'll kind of start at the bottom. And most people have a password. In fact, they've got lots of passwords that they have to deal with. And that's a problem, because the more of these you have, the more you're likely to forget them, the more you're likely to trivialize them. It's just a mess.
Who doesn't have like 50 of them? I know.
Exactly. At least. That would be a small number. So what I talked about in this video was using something that would be stronger than passwords, multi-factor authentication. And with multi-factor authentication, now instead of relying just on something I know, I'm relying on something I have and something I am, or some combination of those different things. Now, in those systems, there may in fact still be a password under the covers that's not necessarily exposed to you. So you might unlock the app with your face looking at your phone and using the biometric reader, and the phone itself being something you have. So that's two factors that I'm using. But the system may actually plug a password in. So the password is not exposed to you directly, but it still exists. Well, the next turn of the crank, or think of this in an evolutionary step, would be a standard that is taking hold these days called FIDO.
FIDO, okay, great. I assume that is not what I'm thinking.
It's not what you're thinking. This is not your pet. This is a fast identity online standard. And what it does is it actually removes the need for passwords in the first place. Now, what you could do is you could use multi-factor authentication in combination with FIDO, and then your browser, the websites can all communicate to each other without passwords at all.
Let me back up just for a second, because when I was coming into work yesterday, I counted how many times I had to log in. I think there were 7 times with Box and email, et cetera, et cetera. I had to provide a login and my password. I understand with MFA, that's going to cause a bunch of challenges. How does that eliminate those challenges?
So what it's doing is FIDO has, we won't go into the details in this video, but there are protocol that exchanges different proofs as to who you are. So the website that's enabled for FIDO, and not all are, but we're seeing them start to more and more become the case, they can communicate with your browser and they exchange secrets and tokens and things like that that happened behind the scenes without prompting you.
But I'm not quite sure I'm following here. Is this a standard or a device?
It is a standard, and many devices then can be FIDO compliant. So you could use different types of devices like your phone or like a particular flash drive that you stick into your laptop, a different type of something you have.
Or like a smart card like we use for getting into the building.
Absolutely. So there's a lot of different types of devices that FIDO would be able to support in that.
Well, that's great, but now it brings me to the PDR, or the Personal Disaster Recovery. And I've had to deal with some disasters because I'm the IT support back at our house. And so what I wanted to do was provide you with a list of potential things to avoid the problem where, what if I lose that device? And to demonstrate that point, you have a cell phone, right?
Sure.
So here's your phone.
There we go.
And listen, man, you travel a lot, too.
A lot. Yeah.
So imagine that Jeff is traveling and he loses his phone either at the airport or worse, loses it somewhere he's not going to return him back to. What is it you do on that travel? How do you recover from that?
Well, the first thing I do after I stop crying is I start trying to figure out how I can recover the device. So maybe find another device, buy another device if I know it's truly been lost, and then I start trying to recover the data. The device itself can be fairly easily replaceable at some cost, but the data is the really critical part. And if we're using that as part of our authentication scheme, then that becomes a linchpin that everything else is relying on.
Well, that brings me then to my main point is, and I want you to take the PDR quiz. There are 8 questions and you get check marks. If you get 4 or more, that's considered a pass. If you get less than 4, then you maybe have some security problems. And if you get 8, you get the golden bean.
Okay. Oh, awesome.
There we go. So the first one is, and this one I think you alluded to is make a backup. And I know that sounds simple. And a lot of people, they back up, if they do, to a cloud.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what you do, I assume?
Yeah, absolutely. I would definitely back up to a cloud because that way you don't have to be at any specific location. You can be anywhere and pull the data back down and restore from the cloud.
But I would argue that you also need to back up to some sort of hard drive device, your laptop, something like that. And the reason is that if you want to get to the cloud, imagine if you're pulling down multi-gigabytes of your favorite photos, that is literally going to take hours. Yeah. Plus, there's another thing is that if you have a local backup, you can have revisions.
Absolutely.
Typically in the cloud, you don't
That's
have
right.
them.
Yeah. And we in the security space refer to ourselves as belt and suspenders. So we don't ever rely on any one thing to keep all together. So if the cloud failed or if the local backup failed, I have backups for my backups.
In fact, I've known people who have had a hard drive fail, and then they found out that their backup, which they've been doing religiously for years, in fact, was corrupted. So it does really happen. The next one on the list, so you get a check mark.
Yeah, I definitely do that.
Awesome, great. The next is that do you update your software?
Absolutely. This one's really critical because what happens in most of those software updates that you see that may be waiting on your phone and you haven't applied yet, there's probably security fixes in there as well. And that means the bad guys know how to exploit your phone and you haven't put in the things to block it if you haven't applied
them. It's practically a race condition.
It really is. And it's a question of, do you apply first the patch or do the bad guys get to your phone and exploit it first?
Fair enough. So you get a check mark.
I absolutely do this.
Now this one, maybe not so. We'll see. And that is, do you actually test your backup?
Sort of. Could be better, but I do test it from time to time. And the best, the one test that I know I end up running on a fairly regular basis whenever I get a new phone, if I upgrade at least every 2 years, then I'd restore from that cloud backup for sure.
And that's actually the test that I say you should give a try is if you upgrade your phone or if you have someone else who's upgrading their phone, try restoring from your backup onto their phone to make sure it actually works.
Yeah.
And the next one on the list is recovery. Now, this is the thing, especially for like emails. You have an email which is using two-factor authentication, and you have to authenticate with that. You've lost your device.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you have a recovery email or recovery phone number, you have a way of recovering from that situation. So there is a really good,
really important to have multiple sources that you've designated, either multiple phone numbers for you, maybe pick another family member or a close friend that you can trust. Another email address, have some backup email addresses yourself. But yeah, definitely you don't want to have your recovery just be one option.
I think you call that an out-of-band sort of situation where
That's
you have something that is not dependent on that particular device that you can rely
That's
on.
Right.
And so really closely related to that is backup codes. And this one might not be quite so obvious. No. A backup code for your email says, I'm going to generate a bunch of random sort of passwords, which are one-time use only, and they bypass all the MFA checks.
Mm-hmm.
Those are really helpful if you don't have the device. That means you can create a printout of it. You can put it in a safe location next to your will or something like that. And that way you have a way of getting back online without having to rely on an out-of-band person. Or
sure.
Other. So, yes?
Yeah, definitely store those.
I'm seeing a pattern here.
Yeah, security guy. We're professional paranoids. What can I say?
Well, here's one that I think I'm going to catch you on. Do you have a sticker on your phone that says, if lost, find?
I do not. It would mess up the aesthetic of my phone, and I don't know if I could deal with that.
Well, I mean, actually, in a true confession, I don't have one either. I really should, but yeah.
It would be a good idea, though. Certainly.
It is a good idea. Yeah. And another good idea is on your account, when you have your account with your cell phone provider, you can add an additional layer of security beyond just the password, a PIN number. So like when you call to change your service, they ask you for that. What do they call it? They have a specific name for it. When it's an, I think you've mentioned that once before. It was when someone is trying to force their way into your
account. Yeah, yeah. So account takeover. ATO is the acronym we use in the security space. So we want to prevent that if someone is trying to get into your account, that they be able to do that. So this is ATO defense.
Did you get that one?
I absolutely do that
well,
one.
Okay. Well, maybe the last one I can get you on, which is a hard one. Okay. This is the, we'll call it the extra credit paranoid one. Is that, and I can tell you from personal experience, this has happened. Your family member goes on a trip, say for example, whitewater rafting, and they lose their phone, right? And it happens to be a $1,200 new phone. Could you imagine how awful that would be?
Speaking hypothetically.
Yes, of course, speaking hypothetically. And what I propose is that you have a travel phone. When you upgrade, have you upgraded to a phone recently?
I'm about to.
Awesome. Yeah. So what you do is, take your old phone and use it when you travel, especially if it's to a remote location or it's an area where you might potentially have a high risk of difficulty of recovering. Mm-hmm. And that's an example of a travel. Do you have that?
I do not. No, I'm going to fail on that one.
Okay, so Jeff's score was six out of eight.
Yeah, okay,
that's really good. So there you go. That's I'm going to wrap it at that. And if you'd like to hear more tech talks, please drop us a comment below. And before you leave, please remember to click like and subscribe.